Emerging construction technologies and real estate and project delivery is the topic for the next session. And I would now like to introduce you all to the session moderator and the speakers in the session. Firstly, I would like to request and invite Dr. Shailesh Agarwal, Executive Director, Building Materials and Technology Promotion Council, BMTPC, to kindly join us on stage. So we have our session moderator joining us in just a minute. I would like to introduce all of you to our session speakers. Please welcome on stage Director, Central Building Research Institute, Dr. N. Gopalakrishnan, joining on the panel. I would like to invite Dr. N. Gopalakrishnan, Director, Central Building Research Institute, to join us on the panel. Shri Anil Devan, HOD for School of Planning and Architecture. Shri Rahul Chopra, CEO, Boards and Panels, Everest Industries Limited. Shri Puneet Narang, Partner, Major Projects Advisory, KPMG India. Shri T. Sriram, Head Residential Business, L&T. Shri Manoj Tripathi, Vice President East, Naredco and MD for Satyabadi Constructions Private Limited. Shri Sudeep Majumdar from L&T Next. Shri Digvijay Singh Tanwar from Director KST Group. I would like to request all our speaker panels, panel speakers to kindly join us on stage and take their positions. Thank you. Ladies and gentlemen, I would once again like to introduce all of you to our speakers for the session. We have Dr. N. Gopalakrishnan, Director, Central Building Research Institute, Sri Anil Devan, HOD, School of Planning and Architecture, Sri Rahul Chopra, CEO for Board and Panels, Everest Industries Limited, Sri Puneet Narang, Partner, Major Projects Advisory, KPMG India, Sri T. Sriram, Head Residential Business, L&T, Shri Manoj Tripathi, Vice President East Naredco and MD for Satyabadi Construction Private Limited. Shri Sudeep Majumdar, L&T Next. Shri Digvijay Singh Tanwar, Director KST Group. Our session moderator, Dr. Shailesh Agarwal, Executive Director for Building Materials and Technology Promotion Council. And also, we are humbled to be having with us on this session IAS Joint Secretary, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India, Shri Amrit Abhijat. We are awaiting his presence. He's going to be joining us in just a few minutes from now. And before sir joins us on stage, we have a very special audiovisual clip for all of you to see. Please pay attention to the screen now. Thank you.
India is undergoing rapid urbanization. There is an opportunity for enormous prospect of growth and transformation. The 400 million plus current urban population of India will rise to around 600 million in 2030 and to over 800 million by 2050. Urban India will contribute 80% to country's GDP by 2050. Under the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, the Government of India is on a mission to provide housing for all by 2022. A paradigm shift is envisaged in technology to fast-track the housing construction process.
Sustainable development and innovative technology ka adhik upyog kaise ho, iske bare mein charcha jaruri hai. Green or clean energy, energy efficiency, water conservation, construction material ka reuse aur apartments mein aadhunik waste management system ko badhawa dena bhi aapki prathmikta honi chahiye.
The Global Housing Technology Challenge India will enable us to deliver maximum number of houses in minimum time and cost. It will create an enabling ecosystem to facilitate technology transition in housing sector, which is green, innovative, sustainable, resource efficient. The challenge has three components. Construction Technology India, a biennial ExpoCom conference to connect with all stakeholders. Identification of proven demonstrable technologies to construct 6 lighthouse projects through challenge process, which will be used as live laboratories for awareness. Supporting potential future technologies under ASHA India. These technologies will get acceleration and incubation support. GHTC India is fully aligned with the various flagship missions. Come, let's use technology and innovation to build a new India together.
Thank you for watching that. And now I would request our session moderator, Dr. Shailesh Agarwal, to lead the talk. We will be joined by Shri Amrit Abhijat very shortly in the panel. Thank you.
Okay, good afternoon, everyone. My apologies for coming late, slightly late. In fact, I was waiting for my joint secretary. He's just about to come. And we have been given 1 hour, so I'll ask each speaker to say a few points, and then we will have discussion, and then followed by question and answers. But before we start, I think NERETCO has been our partner from the very beginning, and our quest towards emerging construction systems, you know, to mainstream these new systems in Indian construction sector has been very rewarding, or rather rewarding, and NERETCO has already supported us. And just now you saw a film, and believe me, all the pictures shown here were the projects which were done under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban using new technologies. And I think JS will come and he will give you the data. But you know, out of total housing shortage of 10 million, 1 crore, 84 lakh houses or 8.4 million houses have already been sanctioned. And out of that 8.4 million houses, around 13 lakh or 1.3 million houses are being constructed with new technologies. And some of these states are very you know, forthcoming, and they have been using these technologies. And all of you know, because one of the point given to me is GSTC pilot projects, lighthouse projects. So all of you know about it. In fact, right from the Prime Minister office, it was desired that we should disrupt the construction sector by bringing technologies which can help in constructing faster and at the same time give us affordable and quality houses. So with that premise, we started our journey and we organized a Global Housing Technology Challenge on 2nd and 3rd of March 2019. And most of you, I think, attended that. NERETCO was our partner right from the very beginning. And I see a lot of familiar faces who contributed into that Global Housing Technology Challenge. And through that challenge, you know, and the response was also very good, very encouraging one. And we could get participation from, you know, more than 20 countries. And we could shortlist 54 new construction systems for Indian construction sector. And believe me, and along with us, CPWD, NBCC, HPL, NERETCO, and other organizations were also there. CBRI, his director is already here. So they also provided, you know, technical and S&T backup for evaluation of those technologies. So we have identified 54 new systems. And what we have done is we categorize them into 6 broad categories. Like we have put them on precast concrete construction, 3D volumetric construction, monolithic, or you know it by shear wall construction system, then you know, formwork systems, then stay in place formwork systems, and light gainer steel structural system. Now I'm just coming from ministry only. Now we have floated a request for proposal, you know, RFP for 6 lighthouse projects. You know, we selected 6 states through a challenge process. And all of you know, or shall I tell you the states, you know, there will be 1 lighthouse project in MP, another one in Gujarat, and then in Tamil Nadu, Tirupura, UP, and Ranchi, that is Jharkhand. So these 6 projects, we have floated the RFP, and we are getting a good response through this platform. I also urge all of you to go to GSTC website, and you know, you can partner with technology providers and bid for this. You know, what we have done is, because we find that technology providers themselves, they do not have that capability to, you know, bid and you know, build such a huge project. So they can come through JV, and all of you who are interested in this, you can have, we can facilitate that also. So you can, you know, talk to those technology providers which are shortlisted and bid for this. So we are getting a good response, and by 28th of this month, we would be finalizing the evaluation, and then we'll be awarding those projects. So those projects, as you know, we have called them lighthouse projects. Those lighthouse projects are going to be a living, you know, live laboratories for all of us, including our, you know, research fraternity, students, you know, and professionals who can go there, study the technology, try to find out the, you know, the pros and cons, shortcomings, and the advantages related with these technologies. So, and all this information is available, you know, on our website, GSTC website, on Ministry's website, and also on our website. And I will not take much time. I have a presentation also, but I'll give it to the organizers. You can take it later. And now, just to introduce my, you know, distinguished panelists here, I see Manoj Tiwari ji, Tripathi ji, then Shri Ram ji, then Diwan Saab Narang ji, then my friend Dr. Gopal Krishnan, and then we have Chopra Saab, then we have Tanwar ji, and Sudeep Majmudar. So what I do is we start like this, or we start from there, and I think being from Narekko, he will speak at the last. okay. So I will start with the professor, or rather I will say director CBRI, N. Gopal Krishnan. And he has been, you know, spearheading Central Building Research Institute. And they have been helping us also regarding, you know, various nuances of these new technologies. There are a lot of, you know, misconceptions about these technologies, their functional requirements, their structural integrity, their disaster resilience, and all those things. So, Dr. Saab, we would like to know from you, do you find these technologies promising? And as a research organization, in order to implement these technologies in the field, what are the efforts which are required to be done? So what I'll do, I'll pose a question to all of you, and you can answer that, okay? Or you can, you know, contribute the way you feel like. And we give 5 minutes to each one of you, okay?
Thank you, Dr. Shailesh. It's a great opportunity for me to sit with real estate developers and be talking a little bit from the research perspectives, which you would like to know. When you see all those real estate players here, as well as builders here, like L&T, I think few of our panelists are from L&T, you just would like to list which are the dominating new technologies that have come through. We have the conventional things which are going, but when it comes to new technologies, which actually give you an edge of fast construction, as someone in the last session was trying to summarize, it's all the money that you have invested and how you are going to get back the money as quick as possible. Like you wanted that to be available to you yesterday itself and you got it now. Now, this is the way. So basically, there are four or five that dominates this whole scenario, as Shailesh was trying to put. It is these structural insulated panels, which we have actually taken from some of these very cold countries, which is actually extremely good for cold. We cannot say when we use large amount of water, it is still going to be a very non-problematic kind of things, which will have EPS, extended polystyrene, or extruded polystyrene, or you have the other few things available. Or you have this light gauge steel. Steel has two or three avatars or two or three variants. Either you use a hot roll section or you use a cold roll section, where in the diagram, whatever the drawings that you are going to make will straight away being converted into rolling process, and a CNC machine gets connected with that, and you have the speed. What drives the whole thing is the speed of construction. This is what it looks to me. And either the cold form steel or it is hot rolled steel. Or you have the precast, as Shailesh was telling, the precast or the formwork. The finally, it looks to us from the spectrum of all those things happening, which gives you economy, viability, as well as quick, this thing, seems to be this formwork based construction where self-compacted concrete is poured into that. Our own perception of this whole thing is seemingly telling us that you ensure a very good quality, you also do a fast construction, you realize your money you have invested onto that as fast as possible. But being sitting in this particular audience where you have a lot of other technologies, it is very important that you need to look at and introspect as to how we can put them also in a very profitable kind of plane. That is the most thing, and the research will be actually helping you to take forward your thing onto your next plane. And we will hear from other panelists. Thank you, Shailesh.
Thank you for your quick submission. Now we have Mr. Rahul Chopra from Everest Industry. Yeah, and I think you are also applying in lighthouse projects. We would like to understand from you that What are the problems you face when you deal with a new construction system? And as he rightly pointed out, technology coming from abroad, being used in cold climate, those kind of things, if you can throw light on.
Thank you, Mr. Agarwal. Dr. Gopalakrishnan made some very valid points. But I thought I'd make one or two points or raise one or two issues that face us in construction today. We keep hearing that there is a water shortage, construction has stopped. We keep hearing there is a shortage of sand, or the cost of sand has gone up, the cost of brick has gone up, construction stalls. We keep hearing there is a shortage of skilled labor to effectively execute construction projects. Training is an issue. Buildings don't perform as they're meant to perform, or they fail because of improper construction or inadequate availability of skilled labor. Then there is the issue of reuse of building products, as we saw in the video, and Shri Modi ji raised it also. The other issue is related to the environmental, to various environmental issues. We have pollution in Delhi, pollution levels go up, Delhi government stops construction. Then there is the issue of debris creation. There is green construction and green construction norms, Greha points and other certification. Yes, sure.
I think please join me.
Ladies and gentlemen,
Shri Amrit Abjad ji.
We are blessed with the presence of IAS Joint Secretary, Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India, Shri Amrit Abjad ji. Sir has just joined us on the panel. And we have a special audiovisual clip for Sir to see. So maybe please play that again.
I think through this platform, I welcome our Joint Secretary, and he's the Mission Director, Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana Urban. He was slightly uneasy in the morning when I met him, and somehow he made it to this session. So thank you very much, sir. And I think we played your film, and if you would like to make a presentation so that everyone knows what we are doing in Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. Are you ready to listen to Joint Secretary? Yes, of course. Yes.
Yes, sir.
I'll from here.
Either ways. You could come here. Then I'll do it. Either way, sir. Sir, please.
Keep coming.
Why are you not playing the radio?
No. And I want to share the presentation first, right?
Yeah. You have to come. No,
I have to
come. Kick. Okay. Okay, good afternoon, everybody. I'm sorry for the slight delay because it's feeling a little too cold today in the morning after the AC. So I went to. Okay, so I look after Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, which is perhaps one of the largest housing programs we are running in the world, perhaps, but I'm not too sure about that, but certainly in the country. I'd just like to share a bit of what we've done, how the journey has progressed. Also, when NAREDCO comes into play in a big way, the roadmap forward. I also want to learn from you what are the other things that we could do to ease the stress on the sector, to be able to do things from the affordable housing side in the real estate coming up in a big way. So let us be more purposeful while I just go through this and after this. See, the Honorable Prime Minister on the launch of the Global Housing Technology Challenge urged us to make this construction technology year, and we are proceeding with it. You will be happy to note that we have initiated a large number of measures, and as we go along in the coming months, you will see that there are interventions both from the policy side, the programmatic side, and also from the legal side. We also feel that there is an element where people need to be trained better with regard to the innovative technologies. We need to introduce curricula. We need to introduce these technologies and an understanding of these technologies amongst the state officials, the urban local bodies. So we have, with the School of Planning Architecture and of course the BMTPC organization with us, initiated a series of programs which we will be doing online and also on a one-to-one basis, and it will be launched very shortly. The program is under preparation, and we cannot share much details right now because we are intending to have the launch done at a very, very high level, where this is absorbed very well amongst the public. Because we got this impression from NAREDCO and CREDAI when we were doing the Global Housing Challenge, that however we drive the policy from New Delhi, people down below in districts like Thane and Bilaspur and Patna need to understand what to do about it, because otherwise they keep implementing the old conventional technology and there isn't much scope for easy improvement on that scale. So these are certain things that we are doing to transform the way construction is perceived in our country and how it's going to be done. I am happy to share that when I travel across Bangalore and parts of Noida, New Delhi, Gurgaon, I already see that there is a lot of traction, and certainly Mumbai, of course, there, where a lot of technology is building upon. But what could we as government do to innovate, to bring in more innovations, one, and to also promote them, is something I would want to hear from you people also. This is usual stuff, you all play with it, how it contributes to the GDP, how it's a very important sector, how it creates employment, and so on and so forth, and how the urban India is poised for growth. These things you would probably be knowing very well, so I will not discuss this in detail. See, the out of the 1.12 crore houses that demand assessments had brought in, demand assessment is a typical method of how we have construed the demand of affordable housing as of now. Let me tell it to you that this is a very dynamic process. It is not cast in stone, it is not frozen. A 17-year-old after 2 years will become a 19-year-old. He will become an independent entity, will probably shift cities to seek for more demand. That is one. He may, the town may be included as an urban center. He may shift residences from Surat to Bombay, then he becomes a fresh demand. So this is a dynamic process. This keeps growing or changing from time to time. But presently the demand is 1.12, and we have been able to do about 85 lakh houses already in progress, and about 52 lakh houses are being under construction, and about 30 lakh odd, I'm not too this thing on the numbers, are people who occupied residences already and are living happily in PMAY houses across the country. This is tied up very well with the state schemes. The private developers also have brought in through EPC contracts and also in PPP mode. But public-private participation is I can say in this closed body hall that it has not picked up in the manner in which we would desire. We think that there is tremendous scope. If there are problems, we would really want the NAREDCO to set up a core committee of how to pick up PPP projects in PMAY, because we have allowed state governments, and state governments have improvised on policies for more FAR, FSI, you know, certain amount of other excise taxation exemptions, but still it did not probably bring in that significant shift as we would have wanted. So what else can be done to be able to bring you people in and also make it more attractive for the buyers, the builders, and for the banker community also, because I believe that funding is a problem. So how to make a viable project? We are looking at schemes, and we would be talking to you. This applies both for the AHP vertical and the ISSR for the slums. The emerging technologies obviously is very important because of environmental concerns, labor issues, resource depletion, and so on and so forth. This is the progress that I've already told you. See, PMAY, one very important thing that is happening simultaneously is that it has promoted huge investments, because while the government of India funds it at an average of 1.5 lakh per house, because we fund more in CLSS to the extent of 2.67, but all in all, if an average is taken, it comes to around 1.5, that's how, for a very broad calculation. Going by that standard, if a house is anywhere between 6 to 10 lakhs, the investment that we are looking at in the BLC and the AHP category is close to 5 lakh crore. But if the houses of down south is taken, probably the limit would be much more. Maharashtra, 30 square feet house probably comes for about nowhere less than 10 lakhs. So this figure could be about 5 to 7 lakh crore in that case, because of differentials across the state. A house in Bihar and a house in Thane or Nagpur we'll have different cost variables that we understand. So, but on an average, the investment is about 5-6 lakh crore, out of which about 3 lakh crore would be coming in from beneficiaries or the banks, and about 1.5 2 lakh crore from the state governments. And the central government is of course standing at 1.32 lakh crore. This gets corrected every month. On the 28th, 29th, we have the another CSMC. Suppose we approved 3 lakh, 4 lakh houses, this goes by another 10-20,000 crores, like that it goes. So here is the investment where you are seeing that these are not figures I am conjuring up from statistical detail, these are figures on ground. If 50 lakh houses are being constructed in India today, out of which 26 lakh has been delivered, on an average 50 into 1.5 or 50 into 6 would give you a figure of 3 lakh crore. So this is the money that is in circulation by virtue of PMAY, whether somebody is buying cement or steel or paying to the labor, this is the traction. We would want you to participate in this in a much bigger way. I feel that affordable housing is the answer to your problems of economy, employment and stress also. Builders who interact with me and those who have shifted their priority for an interim or a transient period and concentrated on affordable housing, I can see that they are happy going to the banks. Environment, these issues, I don't think we need to touch it very distinctly. See, the overall architecture is that global housing challenge is there. Lighthouse projects is something I want to touch upon today. The global housing challenge threw up the concept of a lighthouse project. 6 lighthouse projects, which are considered as demonstration projects also, would be inaugurated shortly, sometime in the month of October. We have bidded it out. The bids are there. It's on eprocuregovernment.in. 54 technologies were selected in 6 broad categories in the Global Housing Challenge. I think you have a great opportunity there that the builder community within the NAREDCO and CREDAI must look up that RFP and TOR document and ally with a consortium or come in as a joint venture, even if you had not participated. If you had participated as a builder or a technology provider, you are most welcome to come as it is. Suppose it was L&T or Saporji Palanji, they have the capacity, they participated, they can come. If they were not participating, they can still come along with somebody who had participated and participate in the bid. And not look at ki ye to saab 400 crore ka ye, hum to 5000 crore ka karte hai. This 400 crores or 500 crores, whatever the net worth of the project will be, is the starting point. If you can nail in your presence in a district or in a state like Ranchi, Jharkhand, or in Tamil Nadu, or in Bangalore, wherever it's happening, or in Bhopal, in Madhya Pradesh, or in Lucknow, you have made a presence for these technologies to be absorbed, because you will not get too much of work in areas where you've already done it. So if a state like Uttar Pradesh can absorb and understand your technology, because government servants, technology providers, IITs and other institutions, all of them will be visiting them. So there will be a greater absorption of these technologies, and do not only look at as a one-off project. It will lead to a series of things. Rome was not built in a day. So this is just the beginning, and we have a good scope there. I urge upon you to look up the website eprocuregov.in and look if you can bid in, because we have, on the request of so many other people, increased the timing till the 30th of this month. After that there is no scope, because we are following a timeline, and we would perhaps want the Honorable Prime Minister, we will be requesting him to formally inaugurate these projects when they actually do. And this we are thinking it to be something that we'll be immensely proud of as the days will operate, because this will be used as lighthouse projects. There will be a lot of gains coming around, and we are also paying much more money. Funding has been ensured. The state government, the central government and the beneficiary will have to operate through a escrow account. They will be RERA compliant, so forth, so forth. So it's not as if a project will get stuck. It has to meet a timeline. It is quite a secure project. And if there is any convincing required, I am available, my team is available. People of NAREDCO was a participant in this event. So you also need to reach out to people, those who are hesitant, because don't tell us later that the government did not invite, or hame to kaam hi nahi hai, or hum to sink kar rahe hain and kaise kare. you know, we have it there. You look up the website. If you feel like, you will make money also. It's not a, you know, it is quite an insured project. Thank you. These are some work which is going on in technology, so I just needed to show you. These demonstration housing projects are what BMTPC has made in various parts of the country where people are already residing. These are such technologies which we make even otherwise, apart from GSTC. It's generally a 40-50 room accommodation which is given out to beneficiaries to stay. But these are made from new technologies and are also used as places where people can go and see what these technologies are about and whether temperature controls are proper, whether the technology stays good, bad, whatever. It is done with the help of IITs also. GSTC, you are aware of. These are the six places where the lighthouse projects will come about. Rajkot in Gujarat, Indore in Madhya Pradesh, Lucknow in UP, Ranchi, Jharkhand, Agartala, Tripura, and Chennai in Tamil Nadu. So these are the six places where we are doing. 1,000, it was an odd, you know, a broad number, but the total number of houses will be 6368. You will also be required to do the external works, which include sewer and all that. So the project size will continue to increase. This is the address, eprocure.gov.in. Here you will get in all the details. You can come in as a joint venture or a consortium partner. This is what I really want to insist upon, because you may say that I had not participated and I really don't know. And don't leave it to your consultant to decide whether you have to get it or not. You get into the spirit of the scheme, because they will say this is not possible. They always do. This is about the course that we are going to say, because my consultants are saying ki bahut mushkil hai, aise hai. We were able to do it. Navreet is the new course that we are looking at. This will give you a large number of people who will know about these technologies as we go along. These are certain photographs of structures you people have actually made it, because we can't say that we have this Pune. I'm sure one of your NERETCO members must have made it here. Precast construction technology. This is monolith. Glimpses of alternate construction technologies. This is how lives are being transformed. These are not imaginary paintings. This is from, one is from Uttar Pradesh, the first one. Second is Jharkhand. You can see the kind of change we are bringing in about. This may not interest NERETCO at a very direct level, but it interests you as a proud citizen of this country that this is how people are sharing their happiness and when they are doing it. This is from Madurai. This is Rajkot. It's a beautiful structure. Vadodara, I come from a state where I was born, and when I served, that affordable housing or government housing was always an apology. Aapko kahin dal denge. There is this road in Patna by the name of Bailey Road, and there is a huge government accommodation there. Usko kabutar khana uska naam hi hai. It's known as kabutar khana, you know, as pigeonholes. These are residences. That is the paradigm shift that we've been talking about. And I'm immensely proud, not only as a government servant doing it, but as a citizen of the country, that we went away from this apology model of housing, confident, dignified houses where people are happy going back in the evening and saying ki ye mera ghar hai, mujhe Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana mein ex builder ne bana ke diya, sarkar ne bana ke diya. This is the change we brought about. This is the way forward, and this is the manner in which we can work together and bring about a huge change in the way housing is conceived in this country, and how happiness comes about when we do things together and share them with the most important person in the country, and that is the people of India. Thank you.
I think he's broadly covered the initiatives being taken by our ministry. And believe me, we have partners. NERETCO is one of our partners, and we have all research organizations, including IITs. I think SPA is also sitting here. They are also helping us in the course, which we are going to launch on 2nd of October. We are also going to launch pretty soon a course on Vulnerability Atlas, because safety is one thing which is being talked about. And believe me, whatever projects we are doing under Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana, disaster is one of the most important thing which we are taking care of. So Anilji, sorry for interrupting you in between, and you can now start your, you know.
Thank you. So just to reiterate, I was talking that we constantly keep hearing there's a water shortage, construction stops. There's a shortage of sand, construction stops. Shortage of bricks, construction stops. There's a shortage of skilled labor. either construction stops or the dwelling unit or the construction that has taken place doesn't perform to the way it's meant to perform. There are issues of reuse of building products. Then there are environmental issues. Pollution in Delhi goes up, or around Delhi goes up, and the Delhi government declares, please stop all construction activity. There's an issue of debris creation. There's green construction issues and certain Griha points and other norms that come into play. There's the issue of topsoil erosion by use of traditional building products like sand and brick. There's the issue of deforestation. And of course, in the environmental, again, consumption of water. Traditional forms of construction consume large amounts of water. Of course, this is all in the backdrop of executing a project on time within certain cost parameters and providing structural integrity to the entire building. Building and construction technologies need to address these issues. The Western world and internationally, people have taken steps to address these issues. India is also progressing in those lines. There are new technologies coming into play in this global housing technology challenge. We also participated. We were able to showcase certain new technologies. They've been in India for some time. It's not that they haven't been in India for some time. These are tried and tested technologies, but the adoption rate has been much slower and the change has been much slower. So I hope as time goes by, as a progressive nation, we look at construction technologies, we look at building technologies which address some of these issues and take forward India to a new era of in construction technology. Thank you.
Okay, now I come to Digvijay. Mr. Tanwar, would you your take on new construction systems and their implementation?
Yeah, actually the system is precasting is very like cost effective as far as this construction field is concerned, but too much of capital initially, I think that is a deterrent as far as using it is concerned. And as far as bankers and the NBFCs are concerned, the more they support the construction sector, the more we can use these technologies to like save money as well as save time. And we can deliver all the commitments as required by the Pradhan Mantri Awas Yojana. Accordingly, we can also contribute to it. And that's one of the factors, because everyone wants to like use these technologies and build and save money and do it as quickly as possible, because it's like helpful for both the ways, like for the customers as well as for the developer. So, but looking at the current scenario, I think as far as the funding is concerned, I think it's a issue with the construction sector due to the sentiments in the market. And I think we need to look at the positive side of it. Like, it's not that everyone is trying in a different angle. And what we are looking at is, of course, delivering everyone on time. And we promise to deliver everything as quickly as possible. But the support from the government side, as well as the bankers, and the declaration of the industry status to the real estate people, that's also a major, I think, step that would help us to quickly contribute more to the 2022 the commitment made by Honorable Prime Minister.
Thank you, Tanwarji. Now I come to Mr. Majmudar. One of the topic given to us is lean construction. You know, we are talking about emerging construction systems, and at the same time going lean is one of the thing, like BIM and other things are being introduced in your construction sector. So would you like to throw some light on going lean construction, or you would like to say something on emerging systems?
Thank you, moderator. Actually, I'm coming from L&T Next, but this is the latest gestational baby of L&T. Probably you have heard of other companies that we acquired recently. So Next is our digital outfit, which we have now just made it outside. So basically whatever we have honed in the last three and a half years in terms of digitally enabled construction. So that is now available for others. Now, what does it mean? So you talked about, you know, Mr. Avijit talked about the crores of houses and the lakhs of crores of money which is coming into this sector. So what we have looked at over the last 3 years when we did digital intervention into the construction operation, because where we find lots of delays, he talked about lots of different kinds of challenges that we have in the construction field. So while you talk about the construction technologies per se, I will possibly more look into how do we make the project management and the execution better through digital technologies. So what we have done, I'll just give you some experience, our experience. Simple, you talked about safety. So what we have done is to ensure safety, we have tagged the helmet with RFID, right? We are taking the data into our big data hub and analyzing. The two things are coming up. One is why we have done it, to ensure safety. Because we feel that the people actually who are supposed to work at the 22nd floor, they should not be on the 40th floor, because I'll have to respond if something happens, God forbid, right? So we are tagging. But at the same time, what is the collateral gain out of it? Collateral gain is the productivity. How much time actually people are there in the geofence zone, right? If you look at the productivity in the Europe and the US of the construction worker compared to India, you'll be amazed to see that. It is 40, 50% higher there, more than that, right? So we are actually in the process of discovering that state and understanding how do we actually, one, ensure safety. Second one is how do we actually, you know, talk to these people, the supervisor, et cetera, because there's an intermediation, right? We can't disintermediate the entire industry. So what we are trying to do is we are trying to talk to these people and get them the facts and figures, the what they're doing and what the people are doing and how do we put the productivity up. Possibly S.N. Subramanian, who is our CEO, he goes to various you know, he's open and public saying that, you know, I asked people to give half an hour more productivity, which is at the L&T scale, means 250 to 300 crores worth of work. If it is 50% are effective or productive, we get straightforward 150,000 crore into our, 150,000 crore into our bottom line. So that's one part of it. So how do we make people more productive through digitally enabled operation? That's a workmen side. Then the machinery. If you look at, it's an open forum. I have spoken with 12 CEOs in front of our CEO, and our CEO said that, you know, we are inefficient. That's a bold statement. But he said that, you know, I knew that we were inefficient, but I didn't know how much inefficient we were. So we actually IoT-ized our operations. So if you look, 100% of the batching plants in the sites anywhere in India and internationally are connected. I know exactly last second what has happened, right? How much productivity, how much utilization, how much aggregates, how much cements have been fed into that. So why we have done that? So again, the efficiency in the operation. So while we are, you know, looking at and building such mass-scale housing or mass-scale any other infrastructure project, we need to be better in terms of construction processes, construction technologies, and understanding what's happening at the last mile, right? I can talk about some, just let me take another example, not exactly on the probably building. There's one example is a motor grader, which actually used in road making. We have seen that OEMs are giving us 27,000 cubic meter, you know, cubic meter per day as an OEM norm. So how much is the construction companies doing? L&T being such a large, efficient company, we are not being able to go more than 10,000, right? More than 10,000. Now we have touched 17,000. We are renorming, we're setting the renorm. So basically, it is attacking the industry to setting our own norms, not the OEM norms, look into the processes, technology, and of course the people who will be using these technologies, who will be actually operating at the site, there is a need to upgrade them. Now, one of the things that actually to do, you know, to an extent, we have been very, very successful. We have introduced VR-based trainings at the site. You'll see that almost all the sites of L&T, you'll be seeing that the VR gear is there and there are modules on safety, on other productivity. We have introduced augmented reality. Possibly, you know, it may sound a music to your ears. A lot of sites are actually augmented, they're using safety training or the other trainings through augmented reality. So the point I'm trying to say again is about, not about the building materials, not about the construction technologies, but how do we make our project management better, efficient, productive? And I'll come back to you if I get some time. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I think you raised a very valid point. Now I come to Mr. Narang. He's from KPMG, and KPMG is pioneer in undertaking a lot of studies. I understand you took a study on green and clean technologies, also on emerging technologies. And as JS was raising a point, we would like to actually understand from you, because you have been traveling across India, that what is it which is preventing this private sector to come into PPP model? Do they don't believe in government, or do they don't find these projects lucrative enough? What is it which is
Thank you, Dr. Agarwal. I think and must congratulate you, Honorable J.S. Saab, for an excellent coverage. I think to your point, Dr. Agarwal, from a point where I'm sitting, when we look at, so we are neutral. I'm not a contractor, I'm not a developer. What's preventing us from taking this to the next level, I think, is the adaptability by the private community. It's not that the technologies aren't available. It's not that it's not, it's happening in parts, bits and pieces. But the real advantage, how we'd be able to reap and achieve that goal and go beyond the 1.12 crore, because that's a start. This is just one scheme, exactly. So to take it to the next level, what will be important is remove two or three aspects which are bottlenecks. I think one is, if I were to call it governance, our understanding of how these technologies need to come into our system. So much disruption is happening. Do I have a roadmap, a plan of which technology is relevant for me? Where, because a lot of real estate development and even infrastructure projects is about location, is about the local ecosystem. You mentioned that we have a good scheme at the center, but it's the state support that's going to be critical. You will need individual inclusive stakeholder consultation sessions at the last mile, because it's awareness. If that awareness is not there, then we will not get the results going forward. So my first point was around governance. Linked to that is standardization. I think our industry, if you look at real estate or construction, it suffers from a very broken down, what I would call completely dismembered, so to speak. So 12 years back, I moved from the US. I spent about 4.5 years there. Today, I feel very happy and proud that a lot of directional strategic thinking is there, but the challenge is in implementation. And when I travel abroad or what we see outside, there are standards which are actually being implemented by every trade. You go to any city, they will use the same codes. Some discussions have happened with the likes of research R&D institutes, NBCC, CBRI, CSIDC, which is talking about material sciences, skilling. So that standardization needs to happen. You travel globally, what do you see? Any city you go to, it's the same standard signage. If you travel in India, what do you see? We're not saying that make this a completely robotic process, retain the vernacular nature, but still get some standardization in our codes, in our construction execution technology, and in processes like Sudeep mentioned. So governance, standardization, and people. I think skilling people. These could be three things that will help technology make it happen for us going forward.
Thank you. I think I've got a message from organizers that I have to finish within 10 minutes. 10 minutes. So we'll come to Anil Diwanji. He's from SPA, and SPA has been helping our endeavor greatly. And so we would like to know from you quickly, maybe in 3 or 4 minutes, that what kind of efforts you are doing in educating the architects or the professionals at your SPA, so that they, when they come out, they start using these technologies, or they think about environment and other things which we talked about. Thank you.
Thank you for this opportunity. So first is, we've been criticized that we are very elitist and we cater to a very few people. So to counter that, I am offering a Arpit program on SWAM, which is a Government of India portal, a course on planning, design, construction and facilities management, free of cost, open to all. Anybody can register and do this course. So the idea is, people can't say that I didn't have the time, I didn't have the money. So you can do it at your will, at your time, and you get a certification, you get the points and credits and all that. So it's a teacher's training program open to all. So this is first, and with the ministry we've been trying to work out and disseminate the total life cycle of all these lean technologies. We come with very basic, simple things. Keep it stupid and simple. So like using modular sizes, using the tile modules to do things so that the labor is less, the wastages are less, the costs are under control. So this is what I want to say. Maybe if I get around, I will speak, or maybe over lunch. Whenever you have some questions for me, I am very keen to answer them all.
Thank you for your quick submission. The next guy sitting here is from L&T. And as you know, we have a lot of expectations from L&T because L&T has been pioneer in the area of emerging construction systems. I understand you have used precast concrete construction, you have used monolithic, name the technology and you used it. A specific question, because we wanted to ask you, it seems you are not participating in our, you know, lighthouse. You need to participate. What is it which is preventing you in, you know, coming and shaking hands with government? This is a lifetime opportunity.
See, L&T has been a pioneer in adopting technologies. When I joined 30 years ago, precast and prefabricated stadium in Chennai was done in 260 days. So it is there for quite long. And we have very recently done, in the last couple of years, few years, we have delivered many houses on precast large panel, wall form panel technology. And in fact, we had a precast factory in Mumbai. Because of lack of demand, we had to close it. So, and the requirements are very large, 1.1 crore houses to be done in the next 2 to 3 years. And the immediate thing that will get hit is quality, obviously. And so technology needs to be there to be used in order to have controlled atmosphere of work, so that the quality is controlled, so that we overcome the challenges of lack of skilled manpower, lack of material, so many other challenges. So there is no element of doubt in that. And all this can be achieved by using the right kind of technology. We are already present. We have done quite a lot of work in this both monolithic construction. In fact, quite recently in the south, in one of the states where unfortunately the construction has stopped, we were doing 100,000 houses, and out of which 60-70% we have finished, 95%, and then the construction got stopped. So we are ready to take that further. In fact, we are ready with the right kind of architectural plans, construction equipment, the formwork, everything is ready. We can do, right now we can do 100,000 houses in the next 1.5 years. Everything is available there. And similarly, in the precast large form wall panel form technology, we already have the, some of the states are coming out with this bid in that. So we will be doing that. So we have no hesitation. We already have done that. Which is, this project being a small, there was a representation from the committee that you are already doing. Why are you, why should you do a small project? That was the question put forward back to us. Because you know we have a threshold value below which there will be a problem with respect to competitiveness. That's the only reason. Otherwise, we already are available in this technology. We will be doing it. There is no issue in that.
Thank you, Shriramji. I think we are running out of time. So Manoj ji, closing remarks from you. Then I'll get back to all of you and I'll ask you. No, I'll ask you a very specific question because...
I am a representative from Orissa. First, my suggestion is that you change the visions of the customers. Customers ka jo aim hai, wo to aayenge, maan ke chalo, main customer ho ke jata hun, ye pre-max ho ki AAC ho ki hot method mein ho, jo construction ka ghar lene ke liye. Private participation jab rahega, to private participation itna bada company hone se, aadmi aapko sochega ki ye jo kaam kar rahe hai, achha kaam kar rahe hai. Nahi to Odisha mein jo aadmi aayega, to bolega, nahi bhai, ye ghar kharaab ho jayega, hum wo ghar ko purchase nahi karega. To mera ye initiative hai, BMPTC ho, ki jo bhi government ke madhyam se, कस्टमर लोग जो हैं उनको आवार करना पड़ेगा और टैक्स के हिसाब से टैक्स पूरा प्राइवेट बिल्डर का जो पार्टिसिपेशन रहेगा तो टैक्स 0 से 2-3% होगा तो अच्छा रहेगा. थैंक्स.
आई थिंक वी हैड अ वेरी गुड सेशन. नाउ सी द लास्ट पॉइंट गिवन टू मी वाज यू नो please listen to me carefully, suggest priority actions to be implemented by Government of India and real estate industry for rapid adoption of emerging construction system. So from all of you, I'll give you 30 seconds. Please tell me the priority actions for us, which we can immediately take. We can, it's like a takeaway for us, which we can take and try to implement. So in 30 seconds, please tell me the priority actions which you feel are the most important to mainstream these new construction systems.
Okay, again, I'll talk about first is data is the new oil everybody talks about. I have got a digital background. When you are having this kind of large housing complexes, right, where are the data going? How are we conserving energy? How are we doing the sewage disposal, right? Where are those IoT gadgets, or where are those electronic or digital systems to monitor that over the next 20 years? How do we say that what we have tried to achieve and achieve it? That's number one. Number two is, I think when I look at the outside world, 3D printed technology needs to be looked at by the government seriously. Right, such kind of mass stuff, I know even L&T possibly we are doing it in terms of R&D, etc. We should be looking at a little bit higher scale than what we are doing right now. I think these are the two things that I wanted to touch upon, especially on the data side.
Thank you. Tanvaji, two or three priority action points which you like government to take or real estate industry.
I think ease of lending, the lending part, I think then we can use all the drones digital technologies to take like control over the particular site and have a look of whatever is like happening on the site and prevent accordingly the any mishappenings that might take place. So I think the priority should be the lending to the sector and ease of lending. I think that eases on, I think then everything works out.
Rahulji.
Thank you. See, I am from a building material manufacturer's perspective. Today, sometimes when you adopt a new technology, there's a certain gestation period. So till you start hitting certain critical volumes, you are a bit wary of taking the next step. You don't know whether to add capacity, not to add capacity, and how do you add capacity. Then when you start adding capacity, then we also face similar problems. In terms of funding, raising capital, putting up factories and projects to ramp up the scale of production. So somewhere, I think if the government steps in and facilitates this and say, okay, that this is something which we believe will work in India, you work with us and you drive it, it will give us a lot of confidence to go ahead and push forward and grow some of these technologies. People like us also open. You give us an idea saying, why don't you work in this area? We are open to looking at technologies that we are even not in, and which is adaptable to our business.
Thank you, Shailesh. Basically, I will put forth three priority areas, which are, again, as my co-panelist put it, it's standardization, codification, and testing, which actually drive that in a very long run of how you are going to make it success. It's the success of concrete or steel is the individual's imagination has given vent to some of the things. And otherwise, if it is manufacturer driven, you are not going to take it too far. So that kind of thing has to be done. And typically sitting in an academic institute or in a national lab, we are actually can be spies to do all those standardization, codification, testing, so on and so forth, which will make it more entrenched, may make the roots more widen of these each of the technologies. Thank you.
I think we'll have closing remarks from JS, but before that we'll come to Naren.
Yeah, so three points that I can clearly highlight. We need to move from construction or project management to production management, which means that your projects don't get built at the site, they get built across the value chain. And if you standardize and go to prefabrication and other things, that'll create more jobs. You link up the manufacturing and the production sector with construction. So that's clearly, and that also answers, you know, your question about lean. Lean promotes that standardization. So move from project management to production management. Second, I think take a end user view. Think from a overall value chain perspective. While you've sanctioned the loans, you've got the land acquisition done, but have strong monitoring at every stage till the asset or the house is handed over, but don't stop there. Take a total cost of ownership view. That means asset management and quality, because that's what makes the difference. It's not just the keys, but what is it going to do over the next 10 or 12 years? That's the second point. And third, I think, is more for the government to what we are doing in terms of increasing awareness, put in place a governance, a mechanism to make this replicated across whatever success you're having. Those are the three points that I would.
Anil, would you like to say something?
Yeah. So just to add what Mr. Puneet said, when we approached few other state governments after our success in PMAY projects in the south, they were unaware about the technologies that are being adapted, and most of the bids were in technology neutral way. So our request is, if government can push that, it has to be through one of the technologies, like what he said, it has to be offsite manufactured, so that the issues of quality, the issues of speed, the issues of lack of skilled workforce, all that will be addressed and we will be able to achieve these targets. So it has to be a push that it has to be with respect to some technology, whether it is prefab, precast or modular wall construction, or some kind of a system formwork. So any of these technologies have to be a criteria for construction.
So what I want to say is that, you know, the skills have to be developed, the trainings have to be given to people. So it has to be balancing of all the things. At the right place, at the right time, the right technologies are to be available, and dissemination of this knowledge is to be given to all.
अवेयरनेस करना पड़ेगा, प्राइवेट बिल्डर पार्टिसिपेशन होगा तो कस्टमर बायर्स का अवेयरनेस बढ़ाना पड़ेगा, सस्टेनेबिलिटी ऑफ द हाउस.
Thank you one and all, and now I would request Amrit sir to at least say some of the things and tell us the takeaways.
I'd request you to pass on this page after. Yes. It's over. Thank you very much. I think as a keen student of social science and history, the way I perceive what has just been discussed is that the days of the construction sector or the real estate industry being one of those places where people would come and fly by night operators, would make quick money, run away, do something very good and not being able to do it further thereon, is probably over. It probably happened for Mumbai film industry some about 3 decades back, and now it's happening in this. The course correction has now stabilized. I think the two major takeaways that we have discussed here is, one is the use of new technology, not only in construction but in management of technologies as well, which is the production management, which is knowledge management, from the climate change perspective, from temperature controls, from use of resources, efficiency of materials. So material management has been talked about. So I think at some point of time we will also, as a government, have to get into what makes a good management, and what needs to be done with regard to the project at site, the skills thing is there. So a very structured model of how a project will be completed in 94 days or 102 days, as you used to say, because when I was used to attend classes in Sussex, they would say that we will meet at 9:55, 10:04. So I wouldn't understand that why, but they actually mean 10:04. So I have seen builders here who are delivering at least 10 days, 15 days before the time. These are the times that we are now placing ourselves in. Second thing is information, knowledge dissemination, because the people need to know what is happening, what is not happening, why he got it, why he did not get it, what is this technology. And I think one takeaway for the government is that we should not only govern sitting from the above, but we will probably have to train, disseminate at the lowest level, because these are the people who interact with the community of builders and all the stakeholders every day. And I think we will also take it as a cue that you're also talking of behavioral change. Apart from knowledge and skills, I think you're also discussing of behavioral change of how one needs to treat the other person and an entrepreneur with dignity, and that is the task that we will mandate onto ourselves, because I quite see that there is a challenge there also. What I would seek from you is that do believe that the government is very sincere and seriously looking at this sector. We are committed to providing you every conceivable assistance that is possible, even things you have not conceived. We are willing to sit down and talk to you people. You have your management. Hiran Nandani ji is here, Bhandarkar ji is here. They have been with us, after us, all the time, and we have been able to make a dent, and we are very willing to carry it forward. I am really, really happy that these things happen, where we get to exchange views and thoughts and ideas, and we have a clear roadmap. We would want you to work with us as we move into the first year of this government. We need to bring in changes so that the sector is not only out from it, but starts flourishing all the way up again. Thank you very much.
Can we take a few questions, if you want? Two, three quick questions. Organizers, can we take? No time? Okay.
So we will take the questions on one-on-one basis, and for now, we would like to thank all of you for putting up such an interesting talk, and we would like to felicitate the panelists. I would like to request and invite Mr. Praveen Jain to join us on stage and felicitate Shri Amrit Abhijat, Joint Secretary for Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, Government of India. Ladies and gentlemen, please put your hands together for Shri Amrit Abhijat. Thank you very much, sir, for taking out time and joining us for this session and sharing your perspective with us. Ladies and gentlemen, please give it up for Shri Amrit Abhijat. I would now request Mr. Gaurav Jain to join us on stage to felicitate our session moderator, Dr. Sailesh Agarwal. Up next, I would like to request Mr. Rajan Bandhelkar to join us on stage to felicitate Dr. N. Gopal Krishnan. Mr. Rajan Bandhelkar to felicitate Dr. N. Gopal Krishnan. Mr. Praveen Agarwal to join us on stage. Mr. Praveen Agarwal, Managing Director for Signature Sattva, to felicitate Sri Anil Devan. Mr. Sukhbir Sharma to join us on stage to felicitate Sri Rahul Chopra. Mr. Praveen Agarwal to felicitate Mr. Anil Devan. Mr. Sukhbir Sharma to felicitate Mr. Rahul Chopra. Mr. Anil Suri to felicitate Mr. Puneet Narang. Mr. S.K. Mittal to join us on stage to felicitate Sri T. Sriram. Mr. Anil Suri to felicitate Sri Puneet Narang. Mr. S.K. Mittal to felicitate Mr. T. Sriram. Mr. Satish Kumar, President Naredco Karnataka, to felicitate Sri Manoj Tripathi. Mr. Satish Kumar to felicitate Mr. Manoj Tripathi. Mr. Sunil Goyal from OMAX to join us to felicitate Sri Sudeep Majumdar. And lastly, Mr. Sachin Pant to join us on stage to felicitate Sri Digvijay Singh Tamar. Mr. Sachin Pant to join us on stage to felicitate Sri Digvijay Singh Tamar. Also, ladies and gentlemen, there was one report that was launched yesterday. There was this one report launched yesterday called Disruption in Real Estate, jointly done by KPMG India and Naredco. And in the hands of Mr. Puneet Narang, we would like to distribute it to all of our session panelists. So may we request for the magazine to come up on stage. And also, ladies and gentlemen, after this, we will be heading on to the last session for the day. It is going to be very, very interesting. We have stalwarts from the various sectors joining us in the session, sharing their ideas. The session is about disruption in real estate sector, the game changer. And for the same, I would request all of you to be seated. Could we please do a group photo on stage with the magazine Disruption in Real Estate, jointly done by KPMG India and Noretco. Mr. Puneet Narang to distribute the report called Disruption in Real Estate. Thank you very much, sirs, for joining us on stage today and sharing your thoughts with us. Now we are heading straight on to the last session for the day. The session is called Disruption in Real Estate, the Game Changer. And I would now like to introduce you all to our session moderator, Mr. Sumit Anand, Global Infrastructure and Logistic Leader from Genpact. May I invite you on stage, please? Thank you very much, everybody. Ladies and gentlemen, I request all of you to please be seated for the last session. Please be seated, ladies and gentlemen, especially everybody here on the left side of the stage. May I request you to kindly take your seats. We are prepping up for the last session for the day, and the session is called Disruption in Real Estate, the Game Changer. Thank you very much, sirs, for joining us on stage. Thank you very much, sirs, for being for joining us in the last session. We are heading to the last session for the day. May I request our session panelists of previous session to kindly make a way for the new speakers to join us. Thank you.
Hold their hands and put them down.
I know, that is what, sir.
Neeraj has been working with you closely. So I work more on the construction side, but we got a good conversation going. Some takeaways. Thank you, that's
good. Ladies and gentlemen, especially gentlemen here on the right side of the stage, may I please request you to kindly not be here. May I request you all to kindly take your seats and everybody else to be seated. We are heading on to the last session for the day. Everybody on this side of the stage, may I please request you to kindly vacate the area. Thank you very much. May I request you to take the seats. Thank you very much once again.
My friends, I'm intervening now because I don't want to speak after the last session because everybody will be hungry for lunch. So I thought I'll just take 1 minute till the people settle down. Please call all the people up. You have already. I'll just take 2 minutes till the session is done. I want to say thank you very much to each and every one of you. Praveen Jain, especially for the organizing of the committee, my chairman and big boss, Rajiv Talwar, all the other members and people from NARETCO, all the vice presidents, people from the organization committee, our brigadier, the entire team of NARETCO at the organizing level, thank you very, very much for actually actively taking it and to be remaining for us all this time. Thank you tremendously for all that is. I want to say that I have a personal delight that in spite of all the negativism that the industry is facing today, we heard a huge amount of positivism that we did. This is more positivism, as you can see. The idea basically being that the thought process that we have done is turned to reach an objective which our beloved Prime Minister has thought of. And this is not just a statement that I'm making in order to please the Prime Minister or the government or the bureaucracy that be. NARETCO is very, very clear that the objective set by the Prime Minister, which is housing for all, in order to see this is there, the technology driven that we talked about, the disruptions that are taking place, which we need to correct in the shortest possible period, will be achieved. So, ladies and gentlemen, let me share with you the optimism that we are bringing to the entire economy in terms of creating the $5 million target that we want to do. We shall achieve it, and real estate will be an important component of that growth center that we are doing. So I want to congratulate each and every one of you who brings about an optimism, who brings about a positive note when everything is really looking downwards. I've talked to many people on the side, and some of them said, oh, but you know, I came so depressed into the meeting, and I was expecting that everything that we are going to talk about are the problems that the industry has faced. The answer is, yes, we are talking every problem that we are facing. Whether it's a liquidity problem, whether it is a demand recession that is taking place, each and every one of the problems we will attack and face. So, we cheer all of you, heartiest congratulations, extremely wonderful that NARETCO is seeing new directions in terms of it. We shall succeed, and we will make the India proud of the real estate industry, that we are the biggest contributors to the GDP growth of India. And this is my commitment to the industry, and it is on your behalf that I'm making a commitment to the government and the Prime Minister. So we shall communicate this message as a conclusive message of this particular session that we have had, that we as an association commit to the Prime Minister of India that we will do a double-digit growth, we will solve the unemployment problem of India, and we shall make it grow. We do need help at this point of time, but asking for help to achieve the Prime Minister's target is not a problem at all. We all will fall, but we will get up and be attacking again. So let's be optimistic and talk about the disruptions, but whatever be the disruptions, we shall succeed. I didn't want to speak after the next session because then we must have lunch quickly. That's why the farewell is to you today, just now. Thank you very much, and all the very, very best. Thank you, Rajiv. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.